They got the good seats. We love you guys.
I mean, didn't you think there's going to be like 10 or 12?
We're not prepared. We were going to, I mean, all we've done is prepare a couple of numbers who'd showboat, and what else do we have? Small expressionistic dancing thing. Stephen came with the bad foot. We can't do that now, right? The dance stuff.
Believe me, I've been to conventions where my panel was, 8 o'clock Sunday morning after everybody was partying. It was me and my mother. Oh my gosh, how is everybody? Did everybody have a good time so far?
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Well, good convention.
Yeah.
I've never been to Galveston. I've been to.
It's someone's phone.
Yeah.
Oh, is it yours?
It is my husband.
We need to do a disclaimer anyway, now that he's hearing music, is that I told you yesterday that I'm pretty sick with the flu, so I have a lot of DayQuil and cold medicine on, and he has pain medicine on, right? Beer and Londo on drugs. Yeah. Like you need us on drugs, you know?
You know, like when you stay in a hotel, you leave the tip for the maid at the end of your stay and everything. I just left 2 Percocet on me.
He's so nice that way. Go ahead. What were you
doing? I'm just going to say, I was going to open it up. I mean, if you have anything you want to talk about, we'd rather answer your questions and rather than us doing the soliloquy.
Absolutely.
Well, we have done camera pretty well.
I always wear tights under my clothes, so I'm always ready to do an expressionistic dance at a moment's notice. I love you people who took that seriously.
No, I don't always wear tights.
Everybody at the
B5
panel last night?
Yes.
Yes.
Anybody not at the B5 panel last night? You might leave, please.
You know, I thought what we could do, if you don't want to do a question and answer, we could lock the doors and just strip down and party and have a real good time. No, I don't want that. No, we don't.
Go.
Not a bad idea, right? Celebrate the Centauri gods.
I got a 2-part question for you.
Oh, a 2-part question. I'll do the Richard Nixon thing.
Where did the accent come from, and are you a fan of Bela Lugosi?
That's a loaded question. Most of you have heard that story, I guess, already about where the accent came from. I'm going to stand up so these other people can see me. And we'll put you on a swivel chair. You can see you up.
That is weird.
Microphone. Yeah.
Should I use this?
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
Yes, I should use this. All right.
Why not? It's there.
Is it on?
No.
Now it's on.
Now it's on.
Yeah, and you can hear me better now?
Yeah.
My hearing is really bad. Here's what was going on in my life at that time. I was doing a play downtown at in Los Angeles of a Tennessee Williams play.
I
didn't include you.
I'm not going to back you up.
That's actually why I like to do a panel with Steve. If I lie, he doesn't tell me, so that's great. It was a Tennessee Williams play. I had to do a Memphis accent or a Southern accent, and I got a bad review, and someone said that's the worst Memphis accent, or in the LA Times, and of course I was crushed, you know. And at that time I got the Babylon 5 script, and it was an alien. But I loved the script, but I had no idea what it should sound like. So I got a hold of the casting people and said, you know, asked them what they would like him to sound like, and they said, you know, you'll be the first Centauri. You can make him sound like anything you would like him to sound like. And it struck me at that moment that no reviewer would ever be able to say I was doing a bad Centauri accent. I made the accent up. So that fueled me to do whatever I wanted to do with it. And I took a little of my Slovakian grandmother, her sound, probably a little Bela Lugosi. I had little, you know, fangs that I saw in the picture that they had. So You know, I just made it up out of that. I was going to Ireland an excessively amount of time in my life at that point, chasing, you know, Catholic girls and beer. And so I tried to put a little Irish rhythms and stuff. And so I just made the accent up. And I guess you tried to do the accent, didn't you, or no?
No, no. The only thing, when I first did the first episode, I had the tea. But,
that's right.
Mine weren't custom teeth. They just went to the gag store and shoved plastic on it. Yeah. And they said, here, try these. I think they'll work. You couldn't understand a word I was saying. You know, I'm about to love you. You know, like that. And they said, that's not going to work. So I just have the eyebrows and the hair and no accent. Because, you know, just like in America, we have different accents and.
Certainly on the planet. I mean, that's what Joe always says. Yeah. You know, something on or the UK, right?
Who's from the UK?
Thank you.
Thank you. That's a great story.
Steven, right after Vera kills the emperor, he starts drinking and stuff. How did you get into that? Because Vera was so innocent and stuff.
Yeah.
And you could just see how devastated he was. How did you get into that mode?
The mode of drinking and being drunk and everything? Did you not see that? I grew up on Dean Wormer. I said, I can't believe I threw up in front of Dean Wormer. And Peter Wiegert says, Kent, you threw up on Dean Wormer.
You're a party animal in life.
I'm really not.
Obviously now, nearly 20 years later, you guys have worked so long together that you've got fantastic rapport and chemistry, and it's felt that way since day one. Now, we already heard the story of how you auditioned for the part, but I want to hear, when did you guys first meet and start figuring out how you were going to work together?
What's that?
Yeah, we were just talking about this.
Walking, you were talking about when you first met.
Well, I wasn't following you.
Really? Wasn't following us. Okay. Well, you tell
the story. We were both on NBC shows. Peter was on a wonderful show, groundbreaking show called Ghost Street Blues. I was on a show called Saint Elsewhere.
Both MTM shows.
Yeah.
Mary Tyler Moore.
Right. And NBC asked us to, separately, not together, asked us to go to something in Minneapolis, Minnesota, called the Fire and Ice Festival. And I went there, and he was there, and it was like 19 degrees below zero, and I was like, why the hell did I do this?
It was like right after the New Year, too, like at this time of year.
It was freezing, and what it is, it's a festival of ice sculptures. And they you know, people compete like American Idol of ice sculptures. And so we were on floats or something. And I met Peter. I had known of him, you know.
I saw Animal House, so I didn't.
And we just met, we hit it off, and he was dating his wife at the time, and you know, and I had two kids already, and that's how we met. And then we worked on Babylon 5, and I was telling him this earlier that I gotta say, I don't want to gush about other actors or anything. Good actors on the show and everything, but there were a couple of actors that I don't even know what you guys can appreciate how good they are. One is Peter, and the other one was Andreas. You know, and I become a director and producer, and my son actually has used Peter. I call Peter, you know, if you had a baseball team, Peter could play first base, he could play left field, he could play shortstop. You know, I call him a utility actor. You say, Peter, this scene you're going to be a homeless man who's being beaten up and you're begging for your life. Peter, now you're going to do the guy beating the homeless man up.
He's on Percocet. Can I believe this? I don't know.
Fantastic, and
Steven,
I directed a film. He had a small part, but I directed a film. It was a part. It was a live action version of a cartoon called Baby Huey, right? And he plays this. You know how parents are coaching little league teams and they get too into the game and everything. And that's what he played. And I got in trouble with the producers because I Peter's one scene was now like 20 minutes long.
Fully meaningless character, you know?
And the producer turns to me and says, why do you have this guy on panel so much? I said, he's hysterical, he's funny. He says, Steve, the children's movie is 3 hours now.
You know, we met in Minneapolis, as he said, but when we met on I'm surprised we were saying on the way over that we didn't meet at MTM on the lot. Because St. Elsewhere just, we were fairly in close proximity. We weren't that far.
It's a very small lot.
Yeah, it's a tiny lot, and we could have run into each other.
It was us, it was Hill Street, St. Elsewhere,
New Heart,
and 30-something. Okay. And that was it. You know?
Yeah, and White Shadow before that. Remember that little show,
White Shadow? White Shadow.
And so I'm surprised we didn't run into each other, but when we met on Babylon's Park, we really did start to act together really easily. Don't you think that's true?
Oh, yeah.
You know, part of it has to do with the fact that that Steven has sort of a director's eye. So you feel like, I wanted to be good for Steven because, you know, I mean, really, he's a good actor. I admired his work. And, so I think we brought out the best in each other, right?
I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, whatever else. It was what it was. And we also, it was a complete, all we did is laugh at one point. By the time we got to the third season, we would just giggle like little girls the whole time. I mean, there was really no reason for us to get paid.
Yeah, we were like, high school boys, just getting in trouble with the teacher. Yeah, they just, they got mad at us because we would just laugh and laugh. And like the Centauri opera scene. And we could not get through that. Anyway, I don't need a good hand up. Yeah.
For Rookie, what was it like working with Ed Washington?
Me?
For both of you.
Both of us.
I, when Ed first came on the show, he was a kind of a, I think he was a relatively new actor. I don't know how much he had done. But he was a pretty nervous guy when we worked with him. And it took a while for him to relax enough to get into the work. So there was a process that went on. I mean, I enjoyed it. And I don't know whether he enjoyed it at first. I think he was but we had good directors. There was a director named Janet Greek, who I liked, and she was great. She helped a lot, and it's not like he needed help, but he just felt the weight of the part and all that. And that was an important character, and he knew it. There was a turn actually happening for all of us, like, wow, who is this guy, and what is this, what do you want stuff, and all that, right? So, but he was, he's a great guy, and, I loved working with him. It was great. So, I enjoyed it.
I like working with him too, but he got a little paranoid with me because every time I see him, I say hi, Ed.
Steve used to do this gesture all the time. Stuff with Wasser was great, though. It was fun. Yes?
Okay.
Oh, go ahead.
Do you have a favorite scene that the two of you together?
Together?
Wow.
Yeah.
There were so many.
Yeah, they really were.
Is this song? It doesn't sound like
no.
It's better than last night because we couldn't hear each other.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite scene?
The truth of the matter is people don't really believe this, but I've never really seen an episode of Babylon 5. So I've never seen it. So I haven't seen much of our work. So I see stuff on YouTube, and I love the stuff on YouTube. Them with the cat thing. What is that? Nibble to death by. Yeah, right. Earth things. Duck feet. No, I can't say duck. I say duck. It's over, right?
You screwed up the job.
Yeah, I already screwed up. So I like that. And what other scenes? We had the. The scene where one of us knew that one was going to die first, and we were both really paranoid about that.
Yeah. Yes. We're both going to be infertile.
That's right.
And then I couldn't pronounce a line. What was that one that you
did? Oh, that's one of my favorite. That's one of my favorite comic moments. And that was a real moment.
Can you tell us right
now? Steven had a line. The line was,
So is that
what... Oh, so that's what this is about. So that's what this is about. And I had to just stand up with an over-the-shoulder shot. So it was just over me onto him. And he said, the first time he did it, he said, oh, so this is what that's about. And then the girl who's off watching script said, no, so this is what that's about. And then Stephen said, oh, so that's what that's about. No, so this is what that's about. And then Stephen did it again. He said, so that's what that's about. She said, no, this is what that's about. And this went on so long.
I had a mental block. I just could not.
I mean, but it was you and her. And he didn't even particularly like her very much. He, you know, she was a real stickler about getting the word right, you know. So this is what this is about. So that's what that's about. And then he, you know, they would echo each other back. Finally, he got it. And the moment he got it, I'm shaking from laughing. So now we got to do it again now. He was laughing. It was a great moment. Yeah. So this is what that's about.
Yeah.
You had mentioned the one person you didn't particularly care about because they were going through...
There were several people I didn't care about.
No, it's like, is there any memorable crew people that...
You really did?
Crew people?
Yeah, that either really, you know, they didn't really like, you wanted to work with, or were really...
Plenty of them. I love them.
Yeah, my favorite person in the world since, you know, I like to eat was the craft service guy. Okay. I love the director of photography.
Outstanding guy.
John Flynn. And, you know, he looks great. Doesn't look old at all. But he shot, he was a director of photography on Gunsmoke. And as a director, I got to tell you, one of my favorite stories as a director, and I was nervous because it was my first time directing Babylon 5. And I said, John, I want this whatever shot was. He just comes up to me, not wanting to embarrass me in front of anybody.
Oh, I've heard this.
And he John talked about this, because he had an accident, and something stuck in his throat.
That's right, yeah.
And it wasn't a piece of gum, it was something else. he just came up to me and goes, you're not going to like what you see. And he walks away.
You're not going to like what you see.
So I changed the shot. I mean, he was great. He just, he had my back and, you know, just one.
I have a Flynn story. He was the director of photography, or was the camera operator, and then the director of photography on Hill Street.
Oh, I see.
So we had a history with each other. And when he, you know, he says, he's got your back, that's really what he did for me and for everybody, I guess. But I would finish a take, and John would be behind the camera, someone else, and he'd go like this. Do another one? It was great. Just give me that. And he is the person who, I always tell this story, there's the, and you can say, tell me what episode it is, where Londo watches the Narn Homeward get bombed.
Yeah.
What's the name of that episode? Do you know, coming to whatever. And John took me for that shot of standing at the window and put me on a platform all by myself. He said he thought it would be great to isolate me for a time before the shot. I mean, this is great direction, actually. And he knew that I was a social guy. I really do like to chat and fool around and laugh on the set. And he said he really wanted to make me, put me alone. So he took a platform like this that I was standing on, and it was about 10 feet high. And he put me on it and just left me up there for the longest time. He said, just think about what this scene is about. And I always thought that was a great move, because it put Londo, put me in the place of this giant alone. I have done this, you know, stand at the window and watch what you have done. Now look at it. It was just a great direction, you know. So that's my John Flynn story. He was great. There was a lot of good people. Peter Kowalski was a great
guy,
our camera operator.
You know, names that, you know, you don't recognize, and, you know, the makeup people.
Yeah.
You have to, it's almost like a marriage. You have to become, you know, get along with them because you're with them so many hours, you know, and especially you, not so much me and stuff. But, you know, the crew was pretty cohesive. I can't remember any arguments among the crew or anything. I had an actor as a director one time, and I had a long shot walking down the hallway. It was three actors, and walking down the hallway, and I went up to, one actor had all the lines, basically. So I wanted to do one on a steady cam, and I'm going down the hallways and everything, and this particular actor would say a line and then he'd pause, and, you know, so a 1.5 minute scene was taking like 2.5 minutes, and it just was dragging. And I went up to the actor and I said, you know, we always start with my actor, my director tricks. We always start with something positive. I love what you do. Now, let's change it. No, I love what you do. Just pick up the pace a little bit, you know, just make it, you know, snap a little bit more. And the actor said, absolutely not. And I said, oh, wow. You know, now, put my director's hat on. This is an interesting. What do you think I did to remedy the situation? I got what I wanted. How did I do that?
Make the camera make faster so it
what?
Make the camera go back faster so the guy had to keep up with you, maybe? Or
no.
Make the other guy say the lines.
Oh. Yeah.
I had no idea. That's a scary
situation.
Well,
what I did was I had to, instead of doing it in one, I had to do a cutaway to the other two actors reacting to what he was saying.
Okay.
So when he came to a big pause, you know, I'd be cutting with the other actor, and all of a sudden his pause was gone. Right. So after the show aired, he came up to me and he said, see, I told you I was right about me. I said, you know what? You absolutely were. I was afraid of you to, you know, hold your ground.
Yeah.
So Peter, you're talking about the cinematographer for that other shot.
Yes.
The other day, of course, preparing for this, I watched the whole thing over again. I had to keep going back to the episode where you find out that it wasn't Reva that had the woman killed.
Adira. Yeah.
Yeah. And that when you smashed up the room.
Yes.
And the cinematography for that, I actually had to go look up the director and the cinematographer. I don't remember who they were, because the camera would spin around you as you did that scene, and that was, and I had seen this a million times, and the a few weeks ago it just caught me.
No, he held the camera. It
floored me. It was like I hadn't really ever seen that.
Who was the director?
I don't remember. No. But the camera was spun around you as you like just, you know, exploded, and it was just so powerful.
It's interesting that you bring that up, and I'll tell you what my perception of it was, because it was just done in a room about as big as this, right? And it was ultimately, I don't remember who directed it either, but Peter Colson, the guy I mentioned, was our camera operator. So he had the Steadicam on his shoulder, or the camera on his shoulder. And he had to do, I was doing this choreography with him, but he had to do a choreography too. It was so great to watch. When I think of it, what I'm watching is this camera operator moving around the room, but with the camera on, you know, but he's doing everything, as they say, you know, Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, she did everything that he did backward with high heels. This guy didn't have high heels on, but he was basically doing my choreography for the scene, but he was doing it all backwards. It was great to watch, and the effect is pretty good, you know.
It really
we only did one or two takes of it, but really, he was really amazing to watch go backwards and carry the camera.
I guess that was part of my second part of my question, was how many did it take, because that had to be way too powerful to keep recreating.
It wasn't about the emotional stuff. I mean, you know, really, it was about the fact that it was a very complex shot and it was hard to get.
And the camera weighs about 60 pounds.
And plus all the steady cam getting smashed.
And hard to keep on, right? He would miss stuff.
It's hard. It takes practice and stuff.
It was incredible.
I've actually done that shot in another film, and it's very difficult. I'll tell you, the trick is to hide the lights, you know, in the lights.
Yeah.
That's more. But in the studios, it's not as bad because you're up high.
That's right.
But I was on location when I did.
Awesome. I just want to say, Peter, all the action and all the serious scenes, my two favorite scenes in all of Babylon 5 when you're chasing the cockroach around. Look at the victory on your face when you finally kill it. Under exasperation, you realize it's a different one.
Oh boy.
With me? No, it's Andreas stuck in the elevator when the gong went off in B5.
Oh, because I had a scene in the elevator with Andreas too.
Oh, that's right.
That was horrible for me. I'm telling you, he is such a good actor, and it's even harder to act under rubber and these red lenses. And, you know, I'm in the elevator, and I'm nervous about around him, you know, the character. And we're in the elevator, and I just, you know, I'm trying to avoid his eyes. And he takes out a knife, and I don't know what the hell he's going to do with the knife. And he cuts his hand, and every drop of blood, he goes, dead, dead, dead. We get the scene, and they go cut, and I went, I'm so sorry! He died. I was just, oh my God, I kept apologizing. And finally at lunch, Andrea said, get away already.
They're dead already. You know, Mira and I were talking last night at dinner about Andreas, you know, and of course we miss him because he was our friend. But, you know, when Stephen talked about what a terrific actor was, he had a kind of double quality. A part of him was very serious about the work and very into it and do a great job. But he was amazingly loose as an actor, too. He would just, he was just loose in front of the camera and comfortable. He was a loose cannon. He would, you didn't know what he was going to do, or and that was just so effective to have. I mean, when we did that elevator scene, so much of that was made up. You know, we were playing a lot of just emotion, so a lot of it was made up anyway. But he was so loose and had such a great time. That's what makes that a great scene, in a sense. You know, I just hold that position, but he was. Before he came to Babylon, I always try to remind people, he had a big career already. He was with Peter Brook's theatrical troupe in England, and they were premier actors, and he acted all over the world, in front of in Iran, in palaces, in Paris, in little villages, in Africa. He really was, before we got him, he was a hot shot actor. I mean, you look at his work as the one-armed man. Once we got him.
Huh?
Once we got
him, we ruined
him. We fixed him good, didn't we? anyway, he really was, you got to look at his whole career. And again, he was quite an actor.
What did you like and dislike about your characters?
What do we like about our own characters?
Yeah, what?
The hardest thing about that I didn't like about Londo, or about playing Londo, was that he was so energetic, and he was so up all the time. You know, I mean, in a sense, he was like a ramped up guy. You know, and so I just had to get ramped up all the time. You can't go in kind of light and easy and have a kind of casual day. It's Londo. Londo doesn't have casual days. He's just not a casual character. So. Because I would have days that I didn't feel like I could keep up with the energy and all that, and you had a pump. So I didn't like that about him. But there was very little else I didn't like. I mean, I had such great lines to say, and everybody talks about the arc. The arc was great. You know, we mentioned that in the talk, and what's interesting is that in most television series, they don't do arcs because it's easier to write. It's easier for the producers and the writers to have, you know, the bad doctor, the cute next door neighbor, and they just write those characters all the time, and the stories come out easier. You're always the bad doctor. You're always the next door neighbor. It's harder if all the characters are moving all the time to stay up with them. So Londo had that too. So I like that. That's what I like best about it.
Not to mention the women.
What's that? Yeah. Oh, my darling. Dear lady.
You had three wives. What were their names?
Famine, pestilence, and death. That's what I really liked about Londo, those kind of lines. You know, that he would say, you know, nibbled to death by, yeah, cats, that's it, nibbled to death like that.
I really like the character I played, and I didn't. There wasn't anything I didn't like about him. Just being yelled at by him all the time.
You like that, or you didn't like that?
It's interesting. I was very nervous and jittery, around it. But one of my favorite lines that he said to me was in the first season. He would be excited about something, and I would say, "But you got to think of something else."
You know, my answer, right.
What was your answer?
You moon-faced assassin of joy. Can you tell he's a director and I'm an actor? He just tells me to do it and I do it. That is something in our relationship. There is that.
Kind of that night, and you know, we had so many scenes together that it was refreshing to have with other people too. One of my other favorite scenes that I had was just a very, very casual scene at the bar talking about our bosses.
Yeah.
I like it.
It was amazing how Stephen took the character, and again, you know, this arc idea, right? And how Veer changed. I mean, if you think about that, if you look at who Veer was here and who Veer ended up to be. It's fantastic. It's a tribute to the writing and tribute to him as an actor. He downplays himself as an actor, but he's the director of the two, but, you know, it's a great
quote. Talking about characterization of characters, what did you nail the character for Laurie and Veer? Because they won. You talk a little bit about what you did to prepare for that, what directions you got to prepare for that?
How you prepared, how you nailed it. You know, first of all, I don't think we nailed it from, I mean, maybe you did, but I feel like in the first season, I was still searching and trying to find out who he was. I had a very strong idea in the pilot who he was, and I liked who he was in the pilot, but I never thought it was going to go to series. I really didn't. I had done, you know, so many pilots that my idea was, you know, do the pilot, it's a job for the summer, and that'll be the end of it. So I had very strong ideas about who Malari was in that very first pilot that we did, but I never knew he was going to be serious. So then the first
the assassin,
the cockroach.
So I felt like I was searching in the first season to find out who he was, and Joe's writing, you know, good writing will do that, to kind of leads you, and you just get like a serious again. You get like a dog on the scent, and you just start to find it, and then finally you start to follow it. So.
The writing was so good that, you know, I was
fine. Did you feel like you had beer from the beginning, or?
Ever since I had the soap in my eye.
Yeah. He's the only one not laughing, the guy. Everybody else knows the story.
Yes, somebody.
Yeah.
This is a little off of Babylon 5. This is Peter.
Yes?
I was watching television about a month ago.
Uh-oh.
And I found this TV series, Night Court.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Yes. I did.
Comes out looking for his mother, and I go, "Wow, that's Peter Jurasik." And of course, it confirmed it on the credits.
Yeah.
Did you do one episode?
I did
one episode of Night Court. What am I, Chop Liver? Yeah. I'm stuck in the elevator with what was it, Marky?
Marky Post.
Oh no, that's Marky
Post.
Marky Post. Oh, you want to hear a funny story? I was.
This is why you want to be with Steve. See? You want to hear a funny story? Yeah, I want to hear a funny story.
I mean, it's coincidental. I was living in this house. We moved because it was not a really nice house, and so I was renting the house. I was going to make an investment. So I said, "Well, I'll just buy another house, but I'll keep this one and rent it out." So this guy calls me and he says, "I'm calling about your house for rent, and I'm telling how good the house is and everything." And I said, and what's your name? He says, John. I said, wait, what's your last name, John? He says, Larroquette. I said, John Larroquette from Night Court? He goes, yes. I said, John, you don't want to rent this house. He said, it's Stephen Furst. Isn't that weird? John Larroquette called to rent my house?
I love that he coughed up the truth to John, just like that. I don't want to get a bad reputation, right?
Yeah.
The development of the Alpha Centauri culture over the 5-year arc, how much of that came from your own ideas, or was that mostly all from the writer's room?
The Alpha Centauri culture, it's really pretty much zero. Nothing came from us. Those were all ideas that, you know, we were kind of following Joe's lead. Stuff like the costumes and Bruce's costumes, that would kind of, to use an overused word, inform you. You know, this guy was talking about the acting process, how you prepare. So that would kind of lead you about who they were. We discovered the Centauris through Joe's vision of who they were. You know, he got the idea about the hair and you know, how they dressed and what they did. But I mean, I look over the history occasionally and think, God, this is way too deep. You know, all we're trying to do is the scene each day, you know.
The costumes were great. I thought
they were beautiful.
They were very heavy, you know. And it was so funny because the material I thought looked so familiar to me. You know,
wow.
So I feel like, you know, I've seen this before. And I went to her and I said, "Where does this material come from? I mean, is it a popular material?" She goes, "Well, it's hotel fabric."
Yeah.
And I think I stayed in the room with that.
She was from the theater, so she it was all really theatrical stuff. All the costumes were great that way. But that leads you down the way.
That's great.
You mentioned the costume. Did you guys get her anything back at souvenirs after the show was over?
Okay, now I can pull up. Yeah. No, you hold on to that.
All right. He comes prepared.
I know I'm going to get this question. When the series was over, you can tell I'm a little bitter. When the series was over, I wanted to keep something from Londo's quarters. I'd done the character for a clip. And so I asked if I could have one of the little statues that were in Londo's quarters. They're a little gold statue about that big that have a little, crest.
Yeah.
And I asked, and they said, we'll have to write to, you'll have to write a letter to Warner Brothers. I'm sorry, and you have to do it in triplicate or something like that, something silly. So I wrote a long letter and said, I really like something. And they came back and they rejected it. Said, no, you can't.
Can you believe that?
You wrote a long letter and they came back and said, no.
No.
And I always thought that was there. And then, of course, everybody said, just steal it, Peter. Just steal it. And, of course, I did steal it. And it's in my office. Somebody else, a fan, sent me. Hold this a minute. See if I can find this. These were the auctions that Warner Brothers did of all the stuff from Babylon 5.
Wow.
And I don't know if you even were aware that everything was auctioned off. And this is
I knew it.
If you wanted Babylon 5 Centauri bomb prop, it sold on June 11th for $911. If you wanted to buy Londo's full costume, you could get it for the low, low price of $7,600. This is why they didn't want me to take the Bravari bottle.
Oh.
$810.
Wow. And all it was a bottle that they stuck a label on.
Yeah. The little Londo prop doll sold for $1,025. I have a statue.
It's great.
Anyway. I just thought that was interesting. Somebody gave you all of these, and everything sold. I should find some beer stuff, or here, Jakar's costume sold for $2,500.
Yours sold for more than this.
I know. I used to tell Andreas that all. I love to piss off the nouns. It was such an enjoyable thing for me to tell this with Andreas.
Let's see. Oh,
here's beer. Here's
costume. Oh. They made it into a bedspread.
$1,000.
Veer's book.
$1,026. Isn't that amazing?
Wow.
I mean, really. So, did I get anything? Yes, I did. I stole.
Okay,
yes.
Yes.
The scene in the third season where Lady Morella has given you the prophecy that one of you will be emperor after the other. And you've got this great scene, just the two of you together, that had a very ad-lib kind of feel to it. Was it scripted, or was it just a stunning development?
That's what we were saying, was one of our favorite scenes, the scenes where we knew one of us was going to be emperor. Yeah, we improv that a little bit. I mean, it was about how we were reacting to each other.
Yeah, the looks are improv.
I mean, it was about being suspicious and just showing that. You know, so much is often just about the images.
Yeah, but it's very much about after you, Bill, after you.
We had fun in that thing, right? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Some of my favorite Londo moments are in the talent movie in the beginning, both when you're on Earth in the younger days and, of course, older as the Emperor. When you're working on the talent movies, like in the beginning, are different? Did it feel different than on the episodes?
Well, it certainly was, and as I said, I thought it was just going to be a little TV movie, and so I thought about the character in a different way. I thought it was like a one-shot deal, and what I always say really attracted me to the character, what I liked, was where Joe positioned him when you first met him. When you first meet Londo, he is in such a corner in his life. He's backed right into a corner. He's at the point of, I'm going to either kill myself on alcohol or blow my brains out or just die from depression. And everybody in life, that's what's great, is that we all understand and know what it feels like when you're in a corner in life. And so I love that about the character. And, you know, that stuff about, and I brought the script, maybe I'll read some of it, because it was the, my favorite part about the Centauris and where they were. All that bitterness he had was such a great thing to play, you know? It really was, to be that bitter and that unhappy. You got just places to go. You're either going to die or you're going to get out of that hole. And so, I mean, I love that. So it was very much different. And then when we launched into the first season, as I said, we were a little bit at sea, all of us trying, you know, where are we going? Who are these people? And what are they going to do? Will you indulge me? You can talk about it.
What?
Can I read a little bit from that pilot?
Oh, yeah.
It's a short speech. I'll keep it fast. I'll do it quickly.
Okay.
Steve, when Steve wants me to go fast, he goes like this.
Any questions for me while he's preparing?
Yeah. It's kind of one for both of you. Just, I've always imagined it had to be a weird feeling. Don't remember the first time you were out in public, like, you know, either by yourself or with friends or family, and saw an action figure of a character that you play.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. It's actually thrilling. You know,
yeah.
One of my biggest career moments, you know, was I became a Happy Meal. I did a cartoon series called Buzz Lightyear in the Circle. I was Booster, and my Happy Meal came out. And I went up and I bought like 10 Happy Meals. Which was quite embarrassing for a 300-pound man.
Now, if that isn't the quote from this panel, I became a Happy Meal. I don't know. That's the one they want to take home.
But you know, as high as you get with the toys, you know your career's on the down low, you know? When you go to Toys R Us and you're on the clearance rack.
Excuse me. Guys.
Yeah, they're not. There's yours, by the way. They don't really look like us, I said.
Yeah.
They don't really look like us.
They're
for you. Oh, no, you want to...
They're for you.
Oh, cool. Oh, hey.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Next.
I can't get up and get them off.
I can't get out.
How nice. Oh, somebody else gave me one of the quotes.
So much. Oh, my gosh.
A little bird told me that you were looking for one.
I was looking for one.
So...
My running joke is, you know, what do you do with this when you get it home? Don't take the clothes off. You know? Have a little respect, please.
The only thing I ask is if I can get a picture with you after this is over.
Yes.
No. Oh.
Absolutely
not. This is mine now.
I think you said, sure, $25.
Yeah, you're going to be Garibaldi.
Oh, my God. I'm going to be Garibaldi.
I didn't really. Let's see, I'll just read this last part. This is what sold me on the character, okay? So,
can we pick up the pace a little bit?
No. He's talking about, Garibaldi comes up and asks him what he was doing and whether he met this guy. So Londo starts up here and says, I was in the casino at the gaming table.
I thought you were out of money.
A man named Del Vano offered to cover my bets. Now there's a criminal if you're looking for him. He promised to back my butts and then he pulled out after I ran up quite a bill. He's right over there if you want to see him.
Can anyone confirm his story?
Yes, the new telepath, Lita Alexander. I saw her talking to Vano shortly after you left. The guy brings him a drink. He says, thank you. Put it on his tab.
Great, right? We'd want to kill the ambassador.
Now, here's the speech, right? Mr. Garibaldi, it's a big universe. If I knew who did it, I would tell you. I'm not here to make trouble. Do you know why I am here? I'm here to prostrate myself to your wonderful Earth Alliance in the hopes of attaching ourselves to your destiny like one of those fish on your world. Attach themselves to sharks.
Remoras?
Yes. Mm-hmm. You make very good sharks, Mr. Garibaldi. We were pretty good sharks ourselves once, but somewhere along the way we forgot how to bite. There was a time when this whole quadrant belonged to us. And now where are we? 12 universes and 1,000 monuments to past glories, living off memories, stories, selling trinkets. My God, man. we become a tourist attraction. See the great Centauri Republic, open 9 to 5, Earth time. Well, my wife told me, I came in right after I read that and said, yes, I want to do the part. She remembers.
You know, I'll do mine. My favorite speech. Yes, Londo, right away.
You know what, I really, I try to be an actor that just follows the script. So, you know, I was surprised by stuff Joe did, but I always realized that, you know, he's the boss.
I mean, it just felt like they were rushing to the end of the series, and they just never covered it. I mean, it was just a throwaway line at the end of the show.
You know, there was a lot of rushing. We didn't know whether we were going to go on, so he would have truncate and shorten stuff, and then finish it and then restart it, and all there was all that, and I understood that was going on too. So, you know.
If you read his comic book arts, they're magnificent. And I can only think that what he had in mind for that would have been too. Yeah. Almost brings it to you.
I'm a good little actor, right? I just do what I, you know.
I'm a utility actor.
I want to work, and I'm going to work.
Actually, kind of two questions. One, going off of that, with the way the series ended, I was wondering if all the actors read like the Centauri trilogy afterwards. I was always curious, like whenever stuff comes out afterwards, especially whenever it's canon that Joe made. Do y'all read the stuff that's kind of past y'all?
I didn't. I'm not a reader of. It's interesting. Again, on the walk in here, we were talking about the movie Her that came out, and that I read. I had a little science fiction book that I had in college that I liked. But I'm not much of a reader of science fiction, so no, I never took an interest in. And as I told you, I didn't even really look at the work. I had enough going on in my life that I wasn't that interested in Babylon 5 and Centauri. So, I mean, I spent a lot of time with the Centauris. I wore the wig a lot, you know? So, outside of that, I was not really very interested in it.
And kind of a second question is for Stephen. The episodes you directed in Babylon 5 were very different than the rest of them, kind of structurally. It wasn't just a straightforward story. There was always some kind of manipulation with images. Or the way the story was told, did you pursue going after those? Or, were you just, how did you end up with those that were kind of so outside of what normal?
Well, I pursued them because I guess you could call this pursuing. I just went to Jim and I said, please let me direct. But those were things given to me. I shot them differently than the normal. And I could have that liberty. If you're guesting as a director on our show, you got to really follow the straight and narrow path. But because I was an actor on the show and I had a little bit more leeway, so I chose to do my episodes a little bit differently, so that answers your question.
Like any good director, you have your own style, and he had his own style as a director with all of us. He felt very different than the people we had. So, and it shows in his work. Yep. We in the back?
Yeah. As actors, you've already said you love your characters, but were there any characters on the show that you saw being portrayed that you said, I'd like to try that, any of the other characters in together, I'd like to give that one a shot?
You got a joke already, right?
No,
Stephen goes right to the joke. You know what, I actually told, I love the idea because I had done some, theater and stuff and repertory, that I love the idea of, I told Joe, we should switch up roles, it'd be great for me to play Narn. I always thought it'd be fun to, but Joe was not into that. I thought it would be great to be a Narn, so that I I don't think there was anybody else I really thought. You didn't want to be a Mimbari, God. You're so serious, aren't they?
Yeah, I never thought about being anybody else. Yes?
How was it like working with the Majel Roddenberry?
I liked Major. She was great. You know, she. Everybody sort of bowed down when she came on. I hadn't seen, very much a Star Trek, and so I wasn't a big Roddenberry fan anyway. But and I was she on this? Did she act also in it? In
yes. Yeah. Yes.
Sorry, I say that I can tell you. Kill him.
She was.
Yeah.
You know,
but,
you know she acted.
Yeah, with us she acted. I didn't know what she was in Star Trek. Star Trek. Did she also act?
Oh,
okay.
In
the
next
generation. She's the only person that's been in every Star Trek series in that movie.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
It was great. It was like being with the Queen somehow. Everybody was like, you know, very, very reverential and sweet to her. It was an interesting. And she was playing that kind of a part, right? She was one of the telepath kind of people.
Yeah.
You know, some of the Centauri women are telepathic. It makes it very difficult for us men. I hate that telepathy stuff. Jeez. Anyway, so it was fun. She kind of fit the character. Do you have memories of it, Steve?
No, not really.
Yeah.
I had a couple of scenes with her, you know. That was it.
Question for both of you, but slightly different. For Peter, was there ever a role as an actor that you saw somebody else do? Any movie, TV would play, where you said, man, I wish I could have done that. I would have had fun with it. And the same thing for Steven as far as directing. Is there like a movie that's come out maybe where you said, wow, you know, I wish I could have put my twist on that. Like, that would have been fun to do.
You must
Oh, yeah, I mean, you know, the constant thing about being an independent filmmaker like myself, you know, you're always searching to get your films financed, you know. So I would love to be at a point where, you know, and I think actors are the same way, is which one am I going to do next? Which script do I want to do next? As opposed to, I love this script, I got to go out and try to raise the money for it, you know. And that's more difficult than making the movie, you know. Because I don't act anymore.
You call what you did acting?
Oh.
We rehearsed that, and he made me do that. And I didn't do it right. Did I make a mistake? Did I mess up on
it? No, it was good.
Well, you can tell me.
Let's go back to one.
One time, just impromptu, he said that one time. I said, somebody said, what are you doing next? And I said, well, I don't act anymore. And he said, you call what you did acting? And it was funny at the time.
Every time we do a panel together, whenever I see him, you know, time goes by, I'm happy to see him. He puts that pressure on me. Every panel. We're going to do that line, huh? You want to rehearse it?
But as a director, it's funny because now I love to go to a movie and get so lost in the movie that I'm not looking at shots and stuff.
Right.
But and that's not necessarily bad. I can't even remember. I recently saw a movie. It may have been 12 Years a Slave, but there was a shot on a ship. It started interior on the ship, and it pushed out past the paddle wheel thing, past that. And I'm still to this day trying to figure out how did they do that shot to go past the water wheel. I'm sure it's some kind of CGI or something. But I always love shots like that. There's one shot I do in almost every movie I directed. I call it the Hitchcock shot. And it's basically you push the camera in really fast, and it's that Roy Scheider shot in Jaws.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's such a great shot. I steal it all the time.
As far as you know, I last time when I said in the panel about being lucky, and that is really true. I'm a really lucky person in life. I have good luck, and I've always had good luck. And so, in terms of acting, you know, I've played a lot of really good, interesting characters. I mean, I got Londo, and I got the guy on Hill Street. Sid was a great character, and I've had a ton of good characters. I played a lot of lawyers and straight people and stuff like that. So there's nothing I dream about, like, oh God, I wish I could have done that. No.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny because you know, I love to play because I'm always playing maybe the nice guy or the innocent guy. And like, I did a movie called Midnight Madness, you know, computer for Disney, and I got to beat up Michael J. Fox. I was like a bad guy, and you know, to this day, I feel so bad about it. You know? I may have caused his, you know, disease.
You brought on the Parkinson's?
Yeah.
They say that. Yeah, I heard that.
I just want to say that you say you haven't watched any of the episodes. We went home last night and watched the two of you kill the Emperor. What you did there, you can call it acting.
Oh, good. I'm going to get around to it at some point. I will.
If you get the time to watch one, that would have to be close to the top of the list. You guys were both just awesome.
And that actor was so good. Wilford Crimley was his name? He had
Crimmer.
Wilford Crimmer. And yeah. He was such a good actor.
I saw Joe's notes about writing that scene, and he said, you know, the whole time Wanda was going to kill him, and then it just popped in his head, no.
Yeah, right?
I'm here's here. I want to do it. And you guys just pulled it off brilliantly.
I did it reluctantly, as I recall, right?
But you see, that's great writing, you know, Londo. That's so human, right? That he thinks good. You know, let him do my dirty work. But I mean, really, you know, I mean, it's a great thing if you think about that. That's a great piece of writing, I think. Anybody else? Any other questions?
Is there any like quirks or anything that y'all developed for the show for your characters that you continue to use after the show?
So do quirks from that. Any quirks did you develop after the show? What a setup! That's a great setup for him. He's going to do some comedy on that.
No, quirks or mannerisms?
Quirks and mannerisms, you know, little things.
The soap in the eye.
There is some, but unfortunately, I'm directing at the time, and it doesn't come in handy. So. I'll go to the script supervisors and go, do you think the shot's okay? You know, I tell you, one of the times I was most pissed off as a director, we had a script supervisor that I did not get along with, and I do this shot, and I said, okay, we can move on to the next scene now, and she turns to me and she says, this scene is, I think her words were, this scene is screaming for a two shot. She's telling me what shots to do. I said, okay, when you direct yours, put the two shot. You know, one thing I hate, I don't like script supervisors most. I don't like them.
I, you know, again, I guess I wanted to get away from Londo more than I wanted to, you know. But it's always interesting to me how some people say to me when they meet me, oh, you're just like Londo. You know, my wife said, oh, typecasting. She did. My real wife said that about it. You know, oh, that's you. And other people say, oh, no, you don't seem like wow, I met you. So that's always interesting to me that I don't feel like I carry. To me, it was a complete character and, you know, had his own walk and talk to. So I can't imagine that people think I'm. But I was in with Barb. We were coming back from a trip in Italy, and we were in the airport in Venice, right? And I'm carrying like a cheese and a salami in my arm.
Like Lucy Show,
exactly. And I'm completely, you know, we're dragged out. We're dragging to the airport because we're tired, and the end of our, you know, whatever vacation was, how long it was. And I'm walking through the airport, and I have sunglasses on, and I'm just, and some guy, as I walk by, says, good afternoon, Ambassador. And I was like, what? How could this guy think that I mean, how did he know that I was on the, I didn't know.
You have bad hair or something?
No, I didn't have the hair. Yeah, I didn't have the hair. He hates when you take jokes, so he
can't. He jokes about his wife all the time. But you've been married, how many years have you been married?
24 years.
24 years. It's four different wives.
could you tell that was coming or not?
Which one do you see? Has that to
you know, last night the last question was a great one of the crew, and many people talked about being grateful, and I just wanted to speak for myself and probably for all of us here before time runs out. We are so grateful you guys take the time to do this. We really enjoy it.
it goes both ways. But we're so grateful for you, and you know, these actors to me, you know, that say, I love these actors who strive to become famous or well known, and then they say, I can't stand the crowds. I can't, you know, then what? Why did you enter this business? You know, that comes along with the territory. It's like an athlete, you know, getting hurt. He goes, I hate being hurt. Well, you're an athlete. You know, you get hurt. But we appreciate you guys so much because without, you know, we'd be doing this, like I said, with my mother in the audience. it's amazing that, and I got to tell you, there's something special about the sci-fi fans. Because what I love about sci-fi conventions is you can come to a sci-fi convention and you're not going to be made fun of, which you might be at another convention. So, you go to a medical convention and you're dressed up as a Centauri?
You know, all I wanted to say is that I came from a theater background originally, and after you finished a performance in the theater, you know, very often people would be outside and you would meet them or, you know, you'd run into the audience. The thing about television work and film work is you never see your audience, you know. We would work out in Sun Valley out there and do, you know, the show. And this opportunity to actually engage you people and for people to say, yeah, it was good, or that worked, or that made us laugh, or I felt that, it's really worked so much. It's so great. So it really is mutual. Yeah. It goes the other way. It's an acknowledgement of our work. You know, we didn't know if we were just doing it, you know, and it goes out.
It's amazing. And this is God's honest truth. It's amazing. Like we said, we don't know if it works or not. It's amazing the uniform comments we get on, like, on certain lines. Yeah. Like, you know, people go to Peter and say, I love this line, and so many have the same line. And, you know, so many people come and say, I love the wave, or I love when you had the bar scene with
Linear.
So, I mean, it's funny how we do get feedback, you know.
Later.
It's great, gratifying, and it makes your life, it makes your work. Your work feel like it's really worth something too. As we get older, it really means something. It's a long time ago, but it's still, you know, it's gratifying. Thank you. I guess we're done.
One more question.
No, it's not a question. Just going along with that, I'm a new fan. I'm here because of my husband, and he made me watch about 5 hours. Okay, he made me, but now your characters, thanks to your characters, I'm a fan now.
Oh, yeah. And,
we're doubly thankful to fans like this who passed it on, because that's how we survived. They got the Babylon 5 germ and they gave it to someone.
Yeah. Right, right.
We especially appreciate you tying her up. Yeah, the video's available if you'd like that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.